This morning I'm offering these reflections, and so just sit comfortably and bring your attention to the presence, just noting the body as it is, the breath, the way it is. With this sense of witnessing, being the observer. Now, the observer, the witness, isn't interested in trying to define or qualify anything, trying to say, how am I feeling, and then try to describe it. But this is where I encourage you to trust just the ability to observe, because so much of our life is unnameable, is not you can't project any word onto it, but you know it. It is what it is. So, like reflecting on the Paccubandhamma here and now, and I found this a breakthrough in my own practice. Just to, even though I could understand that conceptually, but the perceptions of time are so, we give so much validity to them that we operate with the assumption of, I am this person sitting here at 5 o'clock in the morning, and the reality of our life is based on creating a self, time, conditions, identifying with the feelings of the body, with the state of mind you're in. The whole conditioning process is about that, with identity, with definition. So when asked to just be an observer, a witness, we wonder who that is. Well, how do we do it? What do I do to be a witness? And immediately the sense of, I have to become a witness, or try to be a witness at this time. So instead of trying to find out who it is that's witnessing, or how do I do it, if there's any doubt, any struggle, any uncertainty, any question that you're having at this time, observe that. Be the witness to even the doubting state. How do I do it? Am I doing it right? What's the point of it? Or any kind of questions that bring up doubts, uncertainty. Because actually the state of awareness makes us emotionally feel very uncertain. We aren't used to this reality. And on a personal level, we're very much conditioned to seek certainty, verification, certification, certitude. You can see in just human behavior how life is spent on trying to find certainty. Am I doing the right thing with my life? Am I practicing rightly? How am I doing? Am I getting anywhere in my practice? Am I wasting my time? And of course, in the worldly life, people have various views and opinions about this. And we have our own views and opinions. But the witnessing, the knowing, isn't verifying or affirming anything at all, any condition whatsoever. So emotionally we tend to feel very uncertain. So this uncertainty can be witnessed. If I'm feeling doubtful, uncertain about what I'm doing, there's an awareness of that. I know that what do I do next? Am I doing it properly, or on and on like this? Behind this questioning, thinking, uncertain personality is the knower, or the witness, the ability to know in a very direct way. Like being conscious, a conscious entity in the universe, is the experience of knowing, isn't it? We're incarcerated in this physical form for a lifetime. And we experience all the things that happen through the consciousness, through the senses, through sensitivity. And so the witness then is putting our letting go of all the desires and attitudes and positions, identities of worldly conditioning, to trust in a simple immanence of attention in the present. The personality what in Pali, sakya ditti, the sense of a self as identity with the body and the mental state, and this is a habit of the mind. This is not the way it is. It's a created, conditioned habit. The sense of myself as a person, as a, in whatever quality or quantity or whatever it presents itself that I cling to and identify with, that this is something that I can observe. It's an object in consciousness. So just the sense of I am Ajahn Sumedho, this on a conventional level is alright, there's nothing wrong with it. But as an identity that I operate from under all situations, it tends to create endless problems. Because this is an assumption too. I assume that I'm this Ajahn Sumedho all the time. But when I really witness the arising and cessation of Ajahn Sumedho, I see it, this perception of I am Ajahn Sumedho arises and ceases according to various situations. It's not an obsession of my mind. I don't go around thinking I'm Ajahn Sumedho is a continuous experience of life. And so the witness then is behind these perceptions of I am. So this is where I encourage you to start out from this witnessing position. Because so many of us have started out our meditative experiences with the assumption, I am this person who needs to practice in order to get some imagined state to progress according to the way we interpret scripture and attain and achieve by getting rid of the kilesas, defilements, fetters, obstructions, and becoming somehow purified through our getting rid of these unwanted conditions. So the attitude of I'm practicing now in order to get a good result in the future, this is also a creation of thought, isn't it? It's a thought pattern that we may never question. We may operate from that as a, you know, we could spend years, a whole life in monastic form and still never question this basic delusion. So what I'm encouraging you to do during this retreat is, you know, question that basic delusion of I am this person. And by questioning, it isn't by trying to figure out who you are. If you're not this person, then who are you? It's not a matter of finding, you know, who you are, because you'll never find yourself as an object. You'll find everything you find is what they call anatta, not self, when you really put it to investigation. So anatta or not self is a reflection. It's not a doctrinal position that we impose on intellectually onto our experiences, but it's a guide, it's a suggestion, a way of looking at what we ignorantly hold to be ourselves. Now I've found that the self is a creation. I have to think or operate from this blind state of avijja or ignorance. I have to never question it. So all my experience of life is experienced through the assumption I am this person as an ongoing experience. And of course, this is the cause of the suffering of life, because as a personality, you know, we're conditioned in various ways to see ourselves or evaluate ourselves, compare ourselves, identify ourselves, and that's a conditioning process we acquire after we're born. So if I assume I am this kind of person with these kind of problems, these kind of defilements, and that I practice in order to kind of get rid of them, maybe, then I could, you know, I could make myself maybe become a little more careful and as a person, you know, in the society, so I don't create heavy karmic memories to become obsessed with. I can make myself into a better person by being moral, keeping moral precepts, and being kind and generous, and so forth. So this is not to be scoffed at or despised. I'm not against that. But as an end in itself, it leaves one still unfulfilled, because the basic delusion is still intact. So the Buddha was pointing to a completely different way of looking, not from cultural conditioning or from thought or perception, but through awareness. So in terms of Buddhist terminology, then Buddha means awake, aware, attentive, knowing the Dhamma the way it is. So these are words also, and these are conventions just like anything else. But these conventions that we're using, say in the Pali tradition, are not to be grasped as identities or doctrines, but are suggestions changing a way of looking at the here and now, at the experience of consciousness, at the emotional realities that we're experiencing at this time. So instead of me, Ajahn Sumedho, looking at my problems, I change the context from me as a person trying to figure out my problems and solve them into this other paradigm of the Buddha seeing the Dhamma. So this is why we say Bhutang Saranang Gacchami, Dhammang Saranang Gacchami, Sanghang Saranang Gacchami, taking refuge. It's not my personality trying to convince myself I have an inner Buddha or I'm Buddha. That would be a real delusion. My personality can never become a Buddha. I can kind of maybe make myself act like a Buddha, what I think a Buddha should act like, and try to fool myself. But that would be even more harmful. So it's not trying to believe that there's an inner Buddha or that I am Buddha or that my true nature is Buddha, but using the word Buddha as a reminder. What does it really mean then? Awake, aware, the knowing in the present, the witness, the observer, taking refuge in the observer, in the knowing. So that isn't like me trying to take refuge, it's recognizing this simple ability that we all have of being mindful in the present. Then the Buddha knows Dhamma, so Dhamma is the way it is. And this is summed up in the reflections of all conditions are impermanent, all Dhamma is not self. But it's not grasping these as kind of doctrinal positions to take, but to investigate this. All conditions are impermanent. So Satipatthana, Four Foundations of Mindfulness, these are skillful means, way of bringing into consciousness and really noticing the way it is in a direct way, not through a perception of impermanence, but noting the reality of impermanence, that thoughts, emotions, physical sensations, sensory experiences, you know, they have nothing permanent when they arise, they're present. But try to keep them and hold on to them and make them, sustain them, make them permanent. Can you find any permanence? Anything really that you can sustain ongoing in any thought or any emotion? To the body itself. So when we're contemplating the body in the present, isn't it just It's changing all the time. It's a bundle of energy is all it is. You just feel it. You just notice the kind of various movements, vibrations, energies that this body is producing at this time. So that's why the first foundation of mindfulness is the dhyanupassana satipatthana, or mindfulness of the body. So this is a very, very important reflection to bring attention to the experience of your own body at this time. So the knowing, isn't it? The knowing, being aware, embraces the body. You're not, if you really realize the value of awareness, the body is in the awareness. You can observe just this sense of its tensions, whether it's cold or hot, pleasure, pain, energetic experiences, movements, because the body has its own intelligence. You know, we don't have to make our bodies when we eat food. We don't have to direct our attention to digestion. All we have to do is put the food in the mouth, chew it, and swallow it, and the body will take care of the rest. It knows what to do. When it gets tired and sick, and these experiences, we tend to identify, I'm so tired, I feel sick, I'm not well today, and the whole assumption that I am these feelings, this fatigue, and is my problem. But from the position of the bhutto, or the knowing, you're not looking at it in terms of it's my problem, but it is what it is. Feeling weak, sick, tired is like this. Healthy, energetic is like this. So this way of reflecting like this I find valuable, because it isn't saying, it isn't describing or defining, it's just noticing. Now, in the body is, obviously something that was born and will die in the future. So that's a kind of truth that we all recognize. It's a condition, sankhara. It's it's not, and it doesn't have any permanent parts to it. But it is it's a sense condition. It's a sensitive form in the universe. So recognize that at this time, we're experiencing sensitivity. Being conscious entities in sensitive forms. Now this is how I reflect on the way it is. This is the body, this body here is a sensitive form. I'm aware, I can be aware of it, you know, as it as its sensitivity changes according to conditions. Identifying with it, then, out of ignorance, means that I'm limited all the time. I'm limiting myself to the conditions that I'm attached to. So we bind ourselves always to changing conditions, to things that are beyond our control, that are in themselves unsatisfactory. They cannot give you true contentment or satisfaction in life. They can best that we can get from our bodies is the kind of momentary gratification. Sensual gratification has pleasure, but it also is unsustainable. So what is it that's sustainable at this very moment, you know? What is it that isn't changing? That we can take refuge in, that we can rest in, at this very moment, here and now. So this is like inquiring into the reality of this moment. So what I found in my own investigations in this manner is of this ringing sound of silence background. It has continuity. It's like a stream, a flow, a flowing stream. It's continuous. And sometimes I notice it, sometimes I don't. I forget all about it and get caught up in the conditions of my feelings or thoughts, physical experiences. But every time I remember, it's always here and now. So this awareness then is bringing into consciousness, or allowing consciousness to not be clouded with our habitual perceptions of ourselves and the world that we hold as real. Now, calling it sound of silence even the word sound gives us the perception of it's something in the ear. We always connect sound with hearing, with our ears, the organ of the ear. So it's not accurate either, sound of silence, you know? But it is. It's merely a skillful means to kind of, because it does seem like a sound. But if you notice, the nature of sound is it comes and goes. So you have, my voice. I can hum maybe for a few seconds as a continuous sound, but beyond that I can't sustain it. Or the sound of music, or bells, or noises, or whatever. These are the nature of sound is to arise and cease. It's not trying to prove that this is a sound or anything. It's merely convenient reference to this reality that we can easily not notice. And it's surprising how many people who've been meditating for years don't even notice it. Because it's generally not given any kind of name in our tradition. It's not kind of listed on the lists of that we have in the Pali Canon. So, you know, I've known people that do the noting practice, where they listening. And they try to notice through noting what's present, but in this way it's still not investigated. One tends to just put a perception of sound onto it. It's a sound, so therefore it's impermanent. But from my own investigations, you know, not trying to prove that it's permanent, but it will do in terms of experience here and now. It's sustainable more than anything else that's happening at this moment. So in terms of noticing it, I encourage you to, you know, not to look for it, not to try, you know, if you don't notice it, and then you think, I've got to find the sound of silence and practice with that, like Ajahn Sumedho describes, then you're also caught in trying to find something you perceived as something already. Like when we grasp the idea of it being a sound, then we're looking for a sound, a kind of mystical sound, or a subtle sound, or cosmic sound, and these are perceptions, isn't it, that we create with language, and then we try to find them. So in teaching this practice over the years, you see how many people struggle to, because they understand the words, and then they're trying to find something according to some preconception, something that they've already imagined, and trying to find what they're, you know, something that they've imagined that they feel they haven't recognized yet, or they haven't found it yet. So the attitude then is more of, I say, like relaxed attention. Open receptivity. Now these words are advisory words, suggestions of, instead of trying to concentrate your mind and trying to look for something, you know, trying to figure out what it is this it, that it, or whatever, or, you know, put that effort of concentration into the present moment, it's the reverse. It's like opening, relaxing, receiving, letting things just be what they are in the present, and you know, not trying to find anything. It's not something you can find through preconceiving it, but just by trusting in your own ability to be open, receptive in the present moment. So I found these words helpful. You know, we used to teach meditation a lot on concentration, you know, trying to refine, putting attention on the breath and holding the attention to the breath or to an object and concentrating on an object. And so that can become habitual also. We operate from the idea we've got to get samadhi or get something we don't have yet in order to become enlightened in the future. So you have the, you have these different levels of samadhi, and have you, you know, have the jhanas yet, and the whole jargon of way we pick up Dhamma teachings tends to increase this sense of I'm somebody who has to get something. I don't have. Where this attitude isn't trying to get anything. It's not saying you don't have it. It's just that through all your efforts to try to get something for yourself, you're missing. You're not noticing the way it is. So this attitude of relaxed attention, openness, it's like just standing, sitting here and just receiving this moment, you know, not trying to get anything, but just being at ease with yourself. Relax, don't try to find anything or get anything or become anything. I used to notice when I lived in with Lungpo Cha first few years, how I was very dedicated towards strict practice. So I'd do a lot of samadhi practices and sometimes I'd get good samadhi and sometimes I wouldn't, and I'd also feel very kind of critical or upset if people were too, if you know, if there was any noise or distraction, and get, you know, I feel I have to get away from Wat Bapong, too many monks there, too much work to do, I've got to go off to some cave in the mountains and really get my samadhi together. Because the idea of getting samadhi was seemed to be a kind of priority. So then I noticed that I'd get myself into a real tense situation, just very kind of, just very, you know, so intent, so dedicated to practice, so obsessed with the idea of attaining samadhi that after a while it'd just be unbearable. I'd be in a really kind of depressed, negative state if I couldn't get what I was trying to get. Sometimes I could get it, sometimes I couldn't. And when you get what you call samadhi, some kind of samadhi you get through concentrating the mind, then you grasp it. You say, oh, I want this all the time. How do I hold on to this so I have it all the time? And then you feel everything that gets in your way is an obstruction. You know, so you kind of resent things around you, the geckos in the kuti. You're just about getting first jaw, and then they go, dukkha, dukkha. Then you, I can't practice here, there's a gecko in my kuti. Every time I'm just about to get it, it ruins it. You know, we can't kill geckos either. And so I noticed sometimes I'd, you know, through reading Zen books and things like that, they'd have this going nowhere, doing nothing, don't have to become anything, don't have to do anything. And I start just reflecting on this, you know, I don't have to get anything or become anything or be anybody. And then I noticed I start relaxing. I have this sense of, there's this intention of trying to get something all the time is a very, it creates tension in the body. You have to contract and force and concentrate. And this, of course, is for someone like myself, character like I have, is the whole life as a layperson was based on this, of trying to get things or get rid of things. The whole educational process I went through before becoming a monk was all about attaining and achieving through concentrating the mind. So this was something that was habitual. Anything that would increase, would even suggest that, I could easily, be affected by that. You should practice more, you should practice hard, and you should do this and do that, and the whole system was conditioned for that. I needed to get into this tension mode, because it's all about shoulds and trying to get something and get rid of things, trying to get rid of anger, lust, and things like this, trying to get rid of fear. And so the monastic life was one of, on that level, was a constant struggle, because even though it is a vehicle for, conventional vehicle for meditation, now we still have the habits, we're still affected by all our habits that we acquired long before we were summoners. So just noticing reflecting, I remember sitting there in the sala at Wat Pa Pong and suddenly feeling this great relief, not having to strive to get, to become, to get rid of, not being anybody, not having to prove myself, not having to even try anymore, but just suddenly I could feel, just by thinking those kind of thoughts, the tension started falling away. So in this attitude of relaxed attention, like an oxymoron, isn't it? Relaxed attention. We think of attention as kind of forced, like attention, like in the military, the muster sergeant says, attention, you contract immediately into this state, standing stiff, looking good. But relaxed attention isn't an imperative, it's not a command, it's a suggestion. Attentiveness in a kind of open, relaxed way. And then like listening, the ability to listen. Isn't like listening for anything in particular. I'm not listening, focused on any particular sounds going on or thing, but just opening the ability to listen, to receive whatever is happening now. But if I conceive Sound of Silence as some kind of refined, subtle sound, cosmic sound that only arahants can hear, and if I build it up into a kind of hyperbolic, refined state, then I've already conceived it as being something I don't have yet. So then if I sit here, where is it? I don't hear it. Sat here for 3 days now. All I know is this kind of buzzing sound. Maybe expecting, you know, like the angelic chorus or something to come in, something ethereal and sublime. But that's a perception, isn't it? You're looking for something that you've already conceived of, you know, something imagined, or you know, so that is. You won't find it that way. You won't notice it because you'll overlook it because what it is quite ordinary. Nothing special. So don't think of it as some kind of refined attainment that after years of practice you might be lucky enough to have. Then you're creating it into, you know, you're creating something, and then you'll find you'll always be looking for what you're creating, what you imagine. So just see through that whole process of believing your own thoughts, your own imagination, the way you think, and so entrusting in awareness. It's not a thinking process. It includes thinking, but it's not thinking. So thinking arises and ceases. You know, when you really examine what thought is, it's, you know, you try to hold on to a thought. You know, thinking goes from one thought to the next. So you have like the wandering mind, conceptual proliferation, papancha. In Pali they call it papancha, just this wandering kind of mental states where one thought goes on to the next. Because that's the nature of thought. Thought is like that. You know, so we have grammar and we have subject, object, adjectives, pronouns, nouns, verbs, adverbs, and all like this. It's a whole kind of conditioned process that takes place. But awareness then isn't a thinking function. Because the thinking you can't sustain, you know, it just goes on and one thing goes on to the next. So noticing this, that thinking, you can be aware of yourself thinking. So when I, you know, can be, make it fully conscious, I'm thinking about this, that trying to, you know, what I find this sound of silence and what is it, and I can't find it, and maybe I can't do it, or maybe it's not real, maybe Ajahn Sumedho's daft, who knows what. Can you prove it in the Pali Canon? Is it real Theravada? Or is it some kind of Mahayana heresy? So, it is what it's a natural reality. It's not something I'm creating. Something that is not has no name. You know, usually in most of our lives, we have no name for it. And I remember, as a long before I ordained, noticing this, but there was no way to explain it because we didn't have words for it. A buzz in the ear or a kind of peacefulness. I remember one time just where the whole kind of sense of self dropped away for a while, and I was in this state of that kind of bliss of just this ringing silence. And I had no knowledge of what it was, but it certainly, the sense of me, I was about 19 years old then, and this self-consciousness and the self-obsessiveness, and that was just rabid, just totally caught into myself as a person. And then all that kind of, for some reason or other, I wasn't on drugs either, it just dropped away. And there's this is really, there's all that self-concern, self-obsession is not present. This is how I'd like to be all the time. But since I tended to identify it with the conditions, I was in the countryside and things were, I tended to think that I was in the military at the time, so it's easy to blame the Navy and, I can't possibly, got too many other things, too many distractions, and not knowing what it was, having no name for it. But the memory of it, I've held the memory, ever since that day. So then, in becoming a monk, 10 years later, I still didn't have a name for it, but I noticed that in experience, when I let go of all this self-concern, self-obsession, me trying to get something, me trying to get rid of something, when all that kind of gave up trying to do all that and just be kind of relaxed and open, I noticed this vibration. And if I stayed with this vibration, it was quite blissful, actually. It's like, you would, because the thinking process stops. As you notice the sound of silence, the thinking ceases. But then, one falls back into the patterns of habit and that. And say if you don't know what it is or that, you just think it's dependent on the conditions, like being all alone in a kuti, and special conditions would make this possible. So it's easy to think that you can only recognize this or realize this through controlling everything, through trying to repeat the conditions that you remember when you had this knowledge. So in the early years of monastic life, I kept trying to repeat the conditions. And, trying to control the conditions around me, because I can only know this through these special kind of situations. But then I found the real power of the sound of silence came to me right when we lived in London, of all places, big city. Who would have ever thought that you'd realize solitude, real stillness, when you're living in London? impossible. You know, London, you know, the perception of you've got to go up to the cave or the mountaintop. But this really happened in the first year in London. I remembered this, and I started noticing it was with me all the time. And because London is, you lived in Hampstead, which is a rather nice part of London, but still it's noisy and busy and all kinds of, you know, distractions. So this, and remembering this, and recognizing it was, you know, as I had the insight that this, if I, you know, if I use this, develop this, because I couldn't, it was too hard to control the conditions there when you're living in the Hampstead Vihara, trying to make the whole world shut up so you can get your samadhi, just was, you know, an impossibility. So instead of making that request or demand on the world, I developed this awareness around this sound of silence. And found it amazing because even with all the chaos and confusion, the first 2 years in living in London was certainly not peaceful on the conventional side of it, the worldly side of it. It was just kind of an ongoing rat race. But the stillness increased. So, you know, I recognize this is an inner stillness, a still point that could receive the whole chaos and confusion of the world around me, but not make it into a problem, because the stillness is not obliterated by the confusion or chaos of the world. Once you recognize it, then it's you know, it's if you don't recognize it or don't value it, then of course one is, you know, feeling threatened or disgruntled or annoyed by people's demands or worldly conditions or the problems of monks, nuns, and lay people, and so forth. But this stillness then is sustainable even through all the chaos and confusion of the world around. Now in practice, then what I usually do is, because this I've developed this practice for so long, that it's very simple and very natural. It's very, you know, it is natural. It's not a kind of artifice that I create to project onto the present moment. It's not controlling. It's not trying to tell the world to shut up so I can be peaceful. It's not losing control, letting go of all these tendencies, impulses to try to control everything. Now the point is, like the relationship of this to the traditional Dhamma, Yeah, we have Four Noble Truths and the Dhamma of the Pali Canon. So, because this gives us an incredible ability to investigate Dhamma. So it's not in just trying to stop the thought process and stay in a stillness as a, you know, it's not holding the view that I've just got to hold on to this sound of silence and just stop thinking. Because then one goes into kind of an empty state. But one's still caught with the illusion of the delusion of obsessed about not thinking and about this kind of state of where no thoughts arise and trying to hold on to it, and then things will impinge, you know, restlessness and all kinds of things will come up, and it can get pretty dreary because it's a kind of blank emptiness. But in investigation of Dhamma, then it gives us perspective that we don't have when we don't know this. Like perspective, isn't it, is where we can see things and how they relate. We're not just going to one thing and then on to another, losing perspective. So if I'm just, you know, caught in concentrating my mind on various things, and I go from this to that, and I lose perspective. Say, in just visual experience, visual consciousness, you get perspective by opening to the space in the room. We want perspective on this temple. You know, the space in this temple, as a building, as a place to be, you withdraw your obsessions and your fascinations around the things in it to open to the space in it. It gives you perspective on how the different parts of the temple relate to each other and to the whole of it. And so, like, the sound of silence gives that kind of perspective. It has no boundary. It's unlimited, immeasurable. It's not something that, like space in this room, doesn't obliterate the things in it. You know, if we open to the spaciousness, I don't have to tell you all to get out, and you know, and try to destroy the temple in order to, you know, really see the space. The space includes everything. The space in this room includes you and the pillars and the walls and the roof, shrine. So this is what we call, it has no boundary. Space is, you know, we put boundaries on space by building walls, but actually the walls are in the space, aren't they? When you contemplate space, it has no boundary in terms of the reality of now as we're experiencing it. So just putting this relationship of space, form to space, perspective on condition to unconditioned, this is the paradigm, isn't it? To reflect on, to recognize the unlimited, the spaciousness or the stillness has no boundary. So then what arises in it, or what's in that space or in this stillness, can be seen in perspective. It can be seen as in terms of Dhamma, arising, ceasing, sape, sankhara, nicca, all conditions are impermanent. So this is where the Satipatthana, Four Foundations of Mindfulness, really come, you know, is a really helpful tool. Because all it's saying is, you know, to begin to pay attention to the body, the Gayanupassana Satipatthana, not in terms of evaluating it on a conditioned level, you know, not to, you know, not to just be caught in and, you know, trying to analyze and figure it all out with your thinking mind, but to experience the reality of this body as it is now in this stillness. So I don't have to open my eyes and even look at my body, you know, like I said before, I can't see my own face at this moment. You'll have to look into a mirror in order to get some reflection of what my face looked like, but I can see your face better than I can see my own. So this is just a way of reflecting that's not the point in trying to be able to look at one's own face in the present, but to be the, you know, to center oneself in this seeing experience, knowing experience. So in the stillness, then the sense of a self arises and ceases. You know, you can see, you begin to notice the all the urgencies, the obsessions, fear, anger, resentment, jealousy, envy, lust, greed, arise and cease. The physical sensations of the body, you know, the sensory experiences, the sounds through the ear, the odors through the nose, the tastes through the tongue and vision, and what we see through sight. The body itself is totally sensitive, isn't it? Heat, cold, pleasure, pain, neutral sensations. So this reflecting on the sense realities as impermanent, you know, that's what we're noticing there, that they're changing rather than perceiving them as, once I make them into some kind of personal identity or personal problem, they're more than what they are in the present, isn't it? There's like, I have a problem with this, and even when it's not present, I still assume I have a problem as a person. But if I see in perspective, I see there's no self to have a problem anyway. The stillness is certainly intelligent. It's not I don't go into a kind of a dull trance to become a zombie. I'm really alert, fully present. The sense organs are still operating. Thought can still come and go. I can still feel emotions. You know, it's a, you know, of happiness, unhappiness and elation, depression, doubt and worry and so forth. But they're in a perspective now. They're seen in terms of Dhamma. They are what they are, but we're no longer looking at them on a personal level as some kind of problem I have, but as Dhamma, all conditions are impermanent. We're recognizing the changingness of these feelings, of these conditions. So in the stillness, in the still silence, and this gives this perspective on the conditioned realm. So we're not trying, the aim is not to live in a state of a kind of permanent emptiness as a goal by denying or not noticing the world as we're experiencing it through this body-mind experience. But we're learning how to look at this body-mind experience from this perspective rather than from the self assumptions. Changing from the self view, and this is happening to me and my thoughts and so forth, to the Buddha realizing the Dhamma, the reality of the way it is. So anyway, that's enough for this morning, and see this as an opportunity, as an encouragement, encouragement for you to trust yourself more, not to believe all the doubts and views you have about your ability or inability or your barami or lack of it or whatever, not to see through that whole conditioned way you regard yourself. To learning to trust in this because this is the value of being a human being in this time, isn't it? This place. This is possible. This is what we can actually know in a direct way. This is reality. This is not just fantasy life or an illusion that you're creating through becoming a Buddhist. So the Buddha, is a teaching for us, really, for human beings. And so the awakening of this human individual isn't like me trying to become somebody who's awake, but trusting in just the simple attentiveness to this moment, this kind of poised attention, but relaxed and at ease, open, receptive, and let the Dhamma teach you then. Because you'll find the wisdom faculty develops through this kind of attitude.